Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
It's a bit unusual for a mentalist to be performing in front of skeptics. Mostly because the first thought a lot of people have when talking to someone who says they can read minds is, this is normally, I like to do my shows to give people a positive message that the mind is the most powerful tool you have, and that anyone who follows the road to mastery can achieve incredible things. But I want to take a slightly different approach tonight. Even skeptics would like to believe that there are fantastic things in this world. There is nothing wrong with wanting a little bit of magic in life. What is wrong is that there are people out there who will exploit that desire and prey on it. So I want to show you why it pays off to be skeptical of people making psychic claims, because this is how real they can make it look. Could I please get a volunteer to step forward from the audience?
Don't write your 29.
I already wrote that.
Now you're going to have to change it.
Needless to say, social security number is a bad idea.
Credit card number is a
bad idea. On these three cards here, write down a lie about yourself. And when you're done, arrange the cards in a row on the table here in any order you want, but keep track of where the lie is. The lie is.
Wait a minute, you gave me three cards.
Write down the top
three lies.
True statement.
I'm going to drink a gin. What's your excuse? Not me. Three lies, right?
Three true statements. You're on true statement on that one?
Yeah.
Then three lies on those. This is why I don't generally drink before performance.
Should she write one lie?
Three lies.
Three, at least lies.
Okay, I'm confused. Let me try this one.
So when you're done, just arrange them in a row in any order you want, but keep track of where the true statement is.
Shut up.
No, I'm going to keep doing that.
I'm an honest person, so I'm going to try more than anything in lies.
This one is a lie.
How do I call that? That's the truth.
No, skeptics aren't supposed to cooperate. That's the whole point. All right, let's run that again, please. Again, think of where the true statement is. Trading on the card for true value. Actually pretty good odds. And each time narrows it down a little bit more. 33% and then 50%. You know to play the odds right? Not that impressive. So let's step it up a bit. So since I passed over you by mistake last time, we're going to do it a little bit different. You don't have to get up. What we're going to do instead is I'm going to ask you to write down a word, but I know the most difficult thing in the world is turning anything into something. So I've got 40,000 words to pick from. English wine. So, that here. And I'm just going to flip through the dictionary. Stop me any point you like.
Stop.
Any one of these words.
Oh,
awesome. Did you say it out loud?
No, I didn't.
Okay, good. Yeah, that's like reading a mind that was written on a cereal box. Right, turn it face down so I can't see the writing. Hand it to me for a second. Actually, hold the card case and the pen for just one moment. Yes. All right, I'm gonna put this away here. All right, hang on. Concentrate on your word. I want you to imagine that you're sitting in a movie theater. For some reason, I just got a really odd mental image. You're sitting in a movie theater, and on the screen, they project your word in big, bold letters. Okay, it's
little bit of a longer word. A little bit more than, probably more than five letters, I think. Should I, hang on. Anyway, just take the card back and take a look at the word. Give me the rest of it back, please. Thank you. Just take a look at your word and use that as a visual aid to concentrate on a little. Or sometimes it works better. Again, I want you to imagine that you're in that movie theater. Your word is projected onto the screen. Letter at the S. I think there's an I in there, maybe more than one. I think it ends with an IS. Right before the O, there's a T. Okay, let's go. I'm not getting a very clear image of the first letter. I want to say it's a C. Good night, ladies and gentlemen. C L I T O R I S.
It's magic!
Check.
It was right. It was in the dictionary, I'm sorry.
And your eye was just mad at me.
It rhymes with Dolores.
Thank you for rejoining me after those technical difficulties. Thank you for your contribution. He is correct. It is technically in the dictionary, so what can I do? So that was a few orders of magnitude a little bit stronger. Let's step it up one more degree. I need a volunteer from the audience for this one. Here, come on.
Yay!
I don't know where that's coming from. All right, I didn't get your name?
Susie.
All right, what we're gonna do is we're gonna look into past, present, and future. To set this up. Okay, you and I are gonna switch places. We're not doing that again. I used to be a street magician, that's how I cut my teeth. So of course I have too many decks of cards lying around the house.
And just to make sure everything is fair, people accuse me of using a forcing deck. It's all one card. I don't do that. It's not fair. It's just... I do cheat. I just don't like being accused of it. So, I'm going to riffle down and stop me where you like.
Stop.
All right. Take the top card where you cut there. And don't show me, but take a look at it. All right, hold on to that. To start, let's look into the past. I want you to think of a name of someone you knew personally in your past. Just the first name. You did not know Kevin Bacon. Stop it. Three degrees is not the same thing as 1 degree. Please tell everybody the name that you were thinking of.
Ralph.
Exactly. Next, I want you to think of something that you're planning on doing tomorrow. Just think of something you're planning to do tomorrow. Something else. I am not running that down. That's filthy after what he pulled. Some people. Got it? Okay. Could you please tell everybody what you were planning to do tomorrow?
Drive.
Exactly. 2 for 2. All right. Finally, in the past, in the future, let's do present. I want you to think of the name of the card that is currently in your hand. Could you please tell everybody the card you're holding and show it to them?
It's a 3 of hearts.
You know the gag by now.
Exactly.
Just put the card right down there and take the cup. What we did, I asked you to think of things from past, present, and future. A name, a card, and an event. Wrote them all down, little pieces of paper, crumbled them up, threw them in the cup. Dump the paper balls out on the table there and open them up one by one and read them aloud.
Oh. How did you do that? Okay, it says Ralph.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Bye.
Get out of my head.
I don't understand.
This better not say it.
and a seven gray hearts.
Yeah, somebody, let's leave it at that. So far, I've been the one doing the mind reading. But if there's one thing I've learned from watching what they call the shut-eye market, it's not always the case. Who here has heard of Uri Geller? Okay, quite a few of you. The Israeli guy who claims he can bend spoons with his mind, officially filing it under the Avengers C-list of superpowers. And when they got the bow and arrow, it's more useful than you. One thing Uri Geller does is he brings in his audience, gets them to participate, and makes them part of the phenomenon. So let's give that a shot. I need two volunteers, people who consider themselves very, very close friends. In the back there. Participation with the rest of you in that we need a collection of random objects. I need five random, unique objects. I need you guys to contribute. Wait, what do we got here?
This is a vape pen.
Rocket.
Over here.
Vape pen. Got a wallet. A little stuffed monkey head here. What do we got here? This.
It's a lens hood.
Lens hood. And this is a speaker. Okay, we got five. That's good. Like to mix up the objects. Right. Lori, was it? Right. If it weren't for the name tag, that'd be a lot more impressive. And I didn't catch your name. Cindy. All right. Cindy, I want you, looking at one of those objects, write down any one of them, your choice. Just don't say it out loud. Got it? Take my pen back. All right. Lori, would you like to rearrange those in any order you like? Five, left to right or right to left, your choice.
Number them?
Yes. Okay. No, show to the audience. What are you doing, left or right?
Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
All right, evens or odds?
Evens.
Take the evens and move them away into a pile on the side. Are you right-handed or left-handed?
Right.
Right-handed. Raise up your right hand, holding one finger out. Like you're about to call down the god of rage to smite your enemies. Point to one of those objects. Any one you want. The speaker. Take the wallet and the monkey head and put them aside. So, we have five objects. You put them in the correct order, any order you wanted. To you, that was the correct order. Intuitively. We had a process of elimination, getting rid of them one by one. reduce them to only the speaker. What did you write down? Have you ever been so close to somebody that when they get angry, you get angry? When they hurt, you can actually feel it yourself. You ever had that sensation? Well, then I know how this is going to proceed. Can you stand over here just a little closer? Thank you. All right. What I want you two to do, I'll get that. Well, there's no reason to be a tool about it. What I want you to do, both of you, look to the audience. With your feet about shoulder width apart, close your eyes. Deep breath in. Deep breath out. Deep breath in. Deep breath out. All right, keep breathing in, keep breathing out, keep your eyes closed, and wait until I say to open your eyes. You can open your eyes now. Lori, did you feel anything? What did you feel? One tap? Two taps. Which shoulder?
Right.
I didn't actually touch you. I was over here the whole time. So now you see that it's very easy to make simple psychological principles, simple methods of nonverbal communication look like actual psychic phenomena. Maybe there really is a psychic out there somewhere. Maybe they're not even born yet. We don't know. I would love it if that were true. But until then, there are a lot of bad people out there who will try to trick you into thinking they are the real thing. Because they know we all want the world to be wonderful. Don't let them take advantage of you like that. We have this huge, magnificent world around us. If we can't figure out all the mysteries in our lifetime, who cares? This is enough. Thank you.
Miracle mongers and their methods. It was actually one of the first expose books ever written.
Wait, written by Houdini?
Yes. It was really controversial at the time. The backstory to that is that when Houdini's mother died, he took it very hard. At that time in the 20th century, spiritualistic mediums were very, very in vogue, very popular. Houdini went to a seance in hopes that he could say goodbye to his mother. But he found that the medium had rigged up a device to the table to tap it underneath. When he found out, he was furious. So he spent several years traveling the world to learn how these miracle men and women created their effects. Because he didn't want anybody else to be hurt the way he was.
How much of it is like psychology versus like magic tricks?
The balance is different for every performer. In the case of Penn and Teller, for example, you mostly select Penn. In my case, I use as much as I can of psychology and communication theory instead. Because again, the purpose of my show is to give people a feeling that your mind is your most powerful tool. The path to mastery is always worth it. Back there?
Were they all breeds?
Was that?
Were they all breeds?
I showed her at the beginning of the effect. It was not a forcing death. If you want to come up and take a look at it, it won't be that way. Any other questions?
How long did it take you to learn all that?
I have been studying psychology and communication and sociology for about 20 years now, because when I'm 8 years old, I was diagnosed with Asperger's, ADHD, and depression in the span of a year. So I started studying the mind to overcome those disabilities. As for being a mentalist itself, I started out as a street performer in 2007 and eventually evolved into a mentalist with the counsel of my mentors, such as Doc Hilford, Rick Maw, Richard Webster.
I recently
come
up with the word mentalist.
Actually, mentalism was invented in the 1880s. The first mentalists were mostly gentlemen who were using a phenomenon known as muscle reading, the ideomotor response. Simply put, by touching someone, they could feel minute movements in their muscles on a subconscious level to direct them towards certain hidden objects. Some of them would have someone put their hand on the mentalist's forehead and count aloud, and they would be able to name that person's street address just by feeling the pressure of their hand by certain numbers. Yes. About 130 years. As far as performance arts go, it's relatively new. Theater, of course, has been around since ancient Greece. Magic has been around possibly longer than that. That was when the first caveman figured out he could make a rock vanish by hiding it in his palm.
When I was up there, did you use that touch kind of thing to determine which one of mine were truth and lies?
Yes and no.
Because, I mean, I was kind of thinking about that, and I kind of fought very hard not to respond in any way. And it's just interesting to me that if that's what I was thinking, like, I'm not going to respond, you know, that if you were still able to detect something, I just find that interesting.
It was a mix of techniques. That was one of them. I always have a fail-safe just in case.
He drugs you.
That's my job.
Back over there.
Is there any difference in the results that you get, or the how effective your performance is in, say, a crowd like this where people tend to have more of a skeptic mindset than in a general audience?
People using the techniques of a mentalist actually have far more control over their accuracy rating than you might think. In fact, the ones that have lasted the longest and created the largest following of believers have, on average, deliberately got themselves into approximately an 80% success ratio. The reason being is because it seems more realistic. Don't ask me why, but an 80% success ratio seems to be the sweet spot where it seems just accurate enough to be plausible, but not accurate enough to look like fraud.
On that question, Jane Rennie came to our physics department once and did the things, and the various things. And afterwards, he said, physicists are the easiest people to fool. Because they think they're so smart that you can deceive them like this. I'm wondering if that's the same skeptics audience.
Actually, that's very true, very astute. In 1989 through 90, James Randi became aware that Washington University was conducting a series of experiments to see if psychic powers were a valid phenomenon. He sent them a letter listing all these caveats they had to watch out for, and they said, "Yeah, don't worry, we got it covered." Well, Randi doubted that they were sincere about that.
So he found two unknown young men, Michael Brown and Steve Shaw, and he sent them to Washington University claiming to be psychics. Steve Shaw is now an internationally known mentalist going by the stage name Banachek. In fact, what you saw, that last experiment we did tonight with the taps on the shoulder, that was taught to me personally by Steve. He invented entire methods for mind reading, clairvoyance, and psychokinesis on the spot during Project Alpha. And the whole thing was, if they ever asked him, "Are you for real?" he had to tell the truth. They never did. After a year, he, Michael, and Randy agreed, "We can't keep this going. We just feel bad about this now." They came clean. The scientists running the project, they took their slice of whole pie and moved on. Any other questions? All right, thank you all for having me again.